I'd like to ask Dr. Bonnie Anastasi to come up with her panel. Her panel will be talking about health promotion, prevention, and well-being. We have an all-star panel as we've had yesterday and today, and I'd like to ask Dr. Anastasi to introduce her panelists.
Good morning. It's my pleasure this morning to introduce the speakers on health promotion, prevention, and well-being. Our first speaker is Dr. Nav Chana, who is the chairman of the National Association of Primary Care and a general practitioner and senior partner of the Cricket General Medical Practice, where he's been a GP for 21 years. He's also joint director of education quality for health education in South London. As the chairman of the National Association of Primary Care, he serves as clinical lead for primary care innovation. His interests include driving quality in primary care, aligning service with education, and creating systems to deliver population-based health care. Dr. Parinda Khatri, a clinical psychologist, is Chief Clinical Officer of Cherokee Health Systems, which is a comprehensive community health organization with 57 clinical sites in 14 counties in Tennessee. As the Chief Clinical Officer at Cherokee, she provides oversight and guidance on clinical quality, program development and management, workforce development, clinical research, and clinical operations for blended primary care and behavioral health services. She also leads Cherokee's APA-accredited psychology internship program and a postdoctoral fellowship program. She trains, consults, and presents extensively on integrated care. And our third presenter is Dr. Ronald Manderscheid, who serves as Executive Director of the National Association of County Behavioral Health and Developmental Disability Directors. This association represents county and local authorities in Washington, D.C., and also provides a national program of technical assistance and support. He's also adjunct professor in the Department of Mental Health at Bloomberg School of Public Health at Johns Hopkins. He's served as Director of Mental Health and Substance Abuse Programs at the Global Health Sector of SRA International and has held several federal leadership roles in the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services. Throughout his career, he's emphasized and promoted peer and family concerns. Thank you.
Good morning, everybody. On the theme of well-being, just want to check, how are you? How are you feeling? Hands up if you're having a good time. Hands up if you're not. Something happening here today. Forgive my rudeness there. Absolute pleasure to be here in front of such an august and eminent group of people. And I have to tell you, I feel really awkward because I'm really here as a jobbing clinician from South London. But I've been so inspired by some of the things that I've been hearing about today. So thank you very much for that. And particularly thank you, Dr. Troutman, for your words of wisdom, which in some way have kind of got me thinking about what we need to be doing differently in our neck of the woods. So if I can also ask your forbearance, because I haven't done a slide deck, because I'd kind of like to talk to you, if that's all right, and just to kind of let you know my story and hope that in some way it might fit in with some of the things that you're talking about. So I just wanted to say something about me. Since that biography was written about me, I think I've aged by 3 years, because actually it's 3 years out of date. It must be something to do with the time factors or whatever. But I've actually been a family medicine doctor in South London for 24 years, and next year is going to be a quarter of a century playing in the same kind of pitch in Southwest London. And my practice is 1.7 miles away from Centre Court in Wimbledon, for those of you who are tennis enthusiasts. But as we were hearing earlier, Wimbledon Village, where the kind of tennis championships happen, is one of the most affluent parts of London, houses on average around £5-6 million. My practice, 1.7 miles away, that has significant socioeconomic deprivation. And as we were hearing from Dr. Troutman, a 1.7-mile transition in journey equals an 8.5 life expectancy difference. So kind of one bus stop, in the same way we talk about subways, has a major impact in terms of life expectancy. And it's not just because of my practice, if that's what you're worrying about, because there are other things that are going on, as we heard, wider social determinants, et cetera. So that's my practice. And just to give you an idea, because a lot of people have been asking me about, do we integrate and stuff like that. So my practice has a panel of 10,000 patients, most of whom have been loyal members of our practice for ever since I was a young doctor. We have an integrated team of sorts. So we've got a number of doctors. We've got a range of nursing colleagues, ranging from advanced nurse practitioners to a full skill mix. We have a physician associate, and we do have an on-site psychological service and access to physiotherapy and some secondary care clinicians, office-based type secondary clinicians. So that's a model that I'd like to develop a little bit more towards the end of my talk with you, which is the English version of the patient-centered primary care home that you were hearing about yesterday, which we're very proud to be developing in the UK. By some strange quirk of fate, I was elected as chairman of the National Association of Primary Care last year. And kind of all that means is representing a membership organisation, a not-for-profit membership organisations of primary care providers, and by which I mean very liberally people who are involved in that primary care space. So it's not just about the doctors. It's about anyone, any health professional, any organisation that occupies the primary care space. And that's really important, because the way we define ourselves in terms of primary care is not by who provides it, but kind of what the functions of primary care are. And we heard yesterday, didn't we, that primary care has a really important connection, connecting the individual, the person, with a population. And certainly in the UK, the jewel in the crown is that we've had this list-based construction to primary care, orchestrated through general practice, a stable list which you can arguably use for proactive type healthcare, and we'll talk a little bit more about that in a moment. But just to remind you what the purpose of primary care is, because I think sometimes we kind of forget, and I know a colleague mentioned that yesterday, it's the first point of contact that most of us have with the healthcare system. It's a whole person orientated system. So that's physical, psychological, social, spiritual, cultural, you name it. That's kind of what we would want to think about a primary care system to be. And it's a universal access in the UK to a comprehensive healthcare system, which is free at the point of access. And it's based around a capitated model for funding. So it's not based on activity in terms of the way that we are funded. And it's the organisation that's funded, not the individual doctor. And care coordination where that's required when care is required from another sector. And in the UK, a bit like the rest of the world, we've got some significant financial challenges. The NHS, our state-funded healthcare system, runs on an annual budget of £100 billion a year. And we are 30 billion short at the moment, and it's progressively getting shorter and shorter over the next 5 years. And therefore, something's got to change. We cannot continue to be doing the same things we've always been doing. So I wanted to just talk a little bit about wellbeing, because I guess that's why I'm here. I'm a traditionally hardwired biomedical doctor, okay? So please don't think anything different. But I saw the light a few years ago because, as I mentioned, that life expectancy difference in where I practice, it's not changed much in my 24 years. So despite all of our efforts in terms of care orchestration, reorganization, various policy changes, things have not improved. And so I got very interested by how we can mobilize, as Dr. Troutman was saying earlier, the assets that sit in our community, that they actually become a member of our team, so that we're not actually having to orchestrate healthcare through our practice all the time, but actually we use the resources, or the very rich resources that sit in our community. And I got excited by this, by an approach that's been developed in the north of England. Many of you who might know Manchester or Liverpool, there's a place about 20 miles away called Halton. And in Halton, they have 17 GP practices, and the GP practice sits in the heart of a community. So there's a loyal population attached to each practice. And what they've done is they've reframed their practices from being illness places to community well-being places. So there's opportunity to welcome people from the community, to signpost them appropriately to things that will improve their well-being, their opportunity to feel good and function well, through mobilizing the assets that sit in the community. And some very simple examples, like socially isolated elderly being invited in by a voluntary transportation agency to the practice, where they might learn a whole raft of activities that kind of engage them with other members of the community, etc., etc. And the power of community assets is untapped, certainly in my understanding, and something that we should be developing very, very much more. And of course, this builds on the principles of Professor Aaron Antonovsky. Many of you will have heard about Aaron Antonovsky. I'm sorry, I'm 35 years out of date, because he wrote the seminal paper on salutogenesis. Have you heard that term, salutogenesis? Which is actually creating health. It's the opposite of pathogenesis. It's kind of, we get obsessed by the factors that determine disease, and very little kind of excitement around factors that improve health, and that's what salutogenesis is all about. And very simply, there are five ways that we've been building on in terms of our work that can help build resilience in children and recovery in grown-ups, which give them the tools and resources to develop a sense of coherence, which therefore requires them to have less reliance on their healthcare provider. This has been described by the New Economic Foundation in a report that was published in 2009 in the UK. It was a report which was a government think tank on improving mental well-being. And those five ways to well-being, which you can Google and find, are: one, that an individual should have a significant connection with another individual or other group of individuals. That kind of makes sense, doesn't it? That an individual should be active, and that obviously makes sense too. That an individual should learn something new every day, not in the context of your normal work, but something perhaps outside of that. And the individual should give to another person or another organization. So giving to others can make you feel good. And finally, an individual should take notice of the world around them, and actually appreciate things like a beautifully sunny day in Washington right now, and a kind of a construct around mindfulness. And if you think about an elderly person who might be living on their own, like my mother currently, many of those five areas are not well developed, because she's lost her friends, and people like me are off in Washington and not around, and she stopped noticing the environment, stopped learning something new, is really not getting active, etc. And that's a recipe for cognitive decline and loss of executive function. So what we're trying to do is to get people to obviously to be cognizant of the care processes that are required to improve the physical health, but to actually get in those kind of interactions with people, to get them to think about what will build their sense of coherence using those five ways of well-being, and mobilizing community assets in order to do that. So that's pretty much it for me, and I'll perhaps pick up questions later on. Thank you very much.
Hello, good morning. Well, I do have slides, so. Okay, so I'm gonna just give you a general overview of basically our story in, as a community healthcare organization, how we evolved and grew to develop a team-based model of integrated care to, in particularly, address some of the wellness and health issues, as well as pathology issues and social determinants of health. So I'm just going to give some examples for you, just to give a sense of what kind of work we've been doing and some of our struggles and how we've been trying to overcome them. So a little bit about our organization. People typically, they hear the word Cherokee and they think, it's a tribal reservation. We're not. And they see me and they think, of course, this is some sort of tribal organization, and people and job applicants come and say, I'm 1/16th Cherokee, that's why I'm committed to you. So, but actually, Cherokee started out as a very small community mental health center, and it was named after a lake. And so it was opened on Tuesdays and Thursdays, and it was, you know, organized by ladies who lunch. You know, in the South, we have ladies who lunch. And they wanted to provide mental health services to children. And it was in 1968 when it started. And over time, we grew. And really, our mission was guided by meeting the needs of our communities. So we have a saying, Cherokee goes where the grass is browner. And in Tennessee, there is a lot of brown grass. And so over time, we have built, a fairly large, comprehensive healthcare organization that provides both primary care, comprehensive primary care services, as well as the spectrum of blended behavioral health and specialty mental health services. So we have primary care services, integrated behavioral health. We have some dental services, but we have all the trappings of a community mental health center. We have a drop-in center, day treatment, psychiatry, case management. We have a crisis stabilization unit. We have intensive programs for alcohol and drug abuse. We have a mobile crisis team. So we really provide the spectrum of services. We have been guided by need. We are truly focus on providing care to those who need it the most. And so as such, we've had to become creative with very limited resources to meet those needs. So we rely quite a bit on telehealth and technology. So we beam into 23 schools into the mountains so these kids can have pediatric care. About a third of our psychiatry visits are via telehealth because some of our clinics are in such rural areas that we just can't get anyone to go there. So if you look at our clinics and what they are, they really look a little bit different. We have a homeless clinic. We have a clinic that is adjacent to the projects. We have a migrant health center. So we have, and then we have clinics way up in the mountains where, you know, I can't get cell phone service and you need a four-wheel drive just to get there. So I just, first of all, would like to share a little bit about our philosophy. We did not come up with this great model of care. It was our patients who led the way. They showed up at our doorsteps with multiple needs. They had not just physical health needs, they had behavioral health needs, social needs. And so it was really our patients who guided us because nobody would see them. Our patients who came in for behavioral health, nobody would see them for primary care. Patients who came for primary care, we couldn't get them in for behavioral health. And then they needed their transportation needs for food, clothing, shelter. So one of the things I want to just highlight is for us, while integration is our model of care, it is not what we're about. Integration is a means to an end. And I think that's very important. It can be so easy to get lost in putting all your energies into team-based care and integrated care. But if you're not achieving the outcomes, you will be lost. And so I think it's important to recognize the goal is an integration. So far for us, integration has been the most effective way of reaching these goals. So this is something I focus quite a bit on with all of our clinical teams and operational teams is, okay, guys, let's keep our eye on the ball. We want to improve the health of a population. We want to reduce healthcare disparities, improve access. Access is a huge issue for us. I cannot believe the need is out there. We get slammed. We think there is no way there's any more need, and then we get slammed in waves again. So for us, we saw 64,000 patients last year, 16,000 of them were new patients. So we prioritize access. And we wanted to expand into wellness and prevention. Our patients are incredibly sick. When people talk about complexity, I always think it's interesting. People will say three or more chronic health conditions. And we say, that's nothing. That's nothing. For us, we have patients, our average is 6 or more chronic health conditions, plus a number of social determinants of health. But that doesn't mean that we can't focus on wellness and promotion. So just what we don't want to do is be completely, a slave to pathology. We want to focus on wellness and health promotion and well-being for all of our patients and our communities. Just a little bit about our structure of our organization. Clinically, we have behavioral health providers as part of every primary care team. Oh, this is that auto advance, looks like. Part of every primary care team, we have a shared patient panel. The primary care patient panel is my patient panel. We all have population health goals. We have shared space, integrated charts, and our goal is access and collaboration at the point of care. And I tell our folks, if you don't have access to the point of care, even if it's the next day, it's a fail in our mind. It needs to be. We need to organize around the patient. So just some examples of how we have applied and implemented our model of care toward well-being. We have our behavioral health providers, psychologists, as part of every well child check. This is a huge thing. So when kids come in, it's actually their psychologist, behavioral health consultant who takes them back. We do very comprehensive screens for development and behavioral concerns. We can provide quite a bit of anticipatory guidance. And this is critical. For many of our patients, they were not parented. So, I mean, we have to, like, this is how you hold a baby. How do you manage a temper tantrum? We, in 10 minutes, can work with parents and families on how you manage a temper tantrum, and we would much rather do that than give them a diagnosis of disruptive behavior disorder or oppositional disorder several years later. So this has been a wonderful thing for us, because if then issues come up later, there is no stigma, because they've been seeing this, you know, they've been seeing Dr. Allison since they were babies. You know, they see her every year, and so now that there are issues, it just makes sense to see her for those. We also do quite a bit of coordination with the schools. Another area that we've expanded this model to is our prenatal visits. We have 4 OBGYNs, and we saw a real need in the community for good prenatal care for women, pregnant women who are addicted to opiates, addicted to substances, and who are struggling with severe and persistent mental illness. What happened was we were seeing so many babies. Actually, I went to the NICU, and if you ever want to see the most tragic thing in your life, hold a baby that is addicted to, was born addicted to opiates and has neonatal abstinence syndrome. So what we did is we went to all the OBGYNs in the area, we went to the high-risk OB clinics and said, give us your most difficult patients, the patients you don't want to see. And also we went to the shelters and the ERs, and now every pregnant woman who comes in, she meets with the behaviorist and a case manager. We have, you know, the case manager has boxes and boxes of clothes and diapers and all these things, so we do quite a bit of care coordination for them. We also have a centering pregnancy program for our Latino migrant farm workers. So in our migrant health center, we have all of our pregnant moms come in. They meet every week in a group, and this has been great because the issue of perinatal depression has been huge, but if you look, when we do the PHQ-9, it's all zero. It's all zero because there is a sense in the culture, like, if I'm pregnant, I cannot be sad. You know, I need to be happy, and that's something that came out in our centering pregnancy. We learned quite a bit. And then we've also developed a Changes for Life program. If you've ever been to Tennessee, the food is really good and it's incredibly fattening. So what we noticed is our kids were showing up for the well child checks with Mountain Dew and Fritos, and that would be their breakfast. And we looked at our BMI rates and they were double the national average. We were having 5 and 6-year-olds being put on antihypertensives and insulin at age 8, 9. So then what we did is, any child whose BMI is at the 85th percentile or above, we just had them see our behaviorists, and we work with the nutrition, and we were able to track a statistically significant reduction in ZBMI over a 4-year period. So that's an area that we want to target quite a bit. And finally, I just want to talk about our electronic health record. What we've had to do is, because our population has grown so large, we have just been using our EHR to optimize tracking people. So this is an example of our patient dashboard. Anyone in our system, if you're a primary care provider, psychiatrist, psychologist, clinical social worker, when you open our electronic health record, everybody sees the same thing, which is a snapshot on the patient. The red is all the preventive care and well-being care that needs to be addressed, and that is the responsibility of everyone on the team. And then I'm just going to quickly leave you with some quick examples of cultural factors. We see quite a bit of cultural diversity. We have a huge refugee population. Imagine being in a refugee camp in the Congo, and you are running from like soldiers, and you're put on a plane, and you go to a refugee camp, and the next 2 days later, you're in Knoxville, Tennessee. So lessons in cultural humility, what we have learned in our prevention. Agua fresca is not truly fresh water, which I realized. It's a highly sweetened beverage, and we were telling people it's great. Agua fresca, through the interpreter, it's great for our refugees. And then someone said, taste this, it's delicious. It's very, very high in sugar. So, you know, this is an example of, we had to learn a lesson. Our refugees, what we learned with health promotion is, if they didn't get a shot, they didn't think they were getting care. Because in the refugee camps, that's what you did. You went to the refugee camp, you got a shot, and so they would be so frustrated with us. So things like, how do you say I miss my family in Kurundi? We do refugee clinics, and our psychologist, a person said, my head. Every single person in this family had such headache pain, and when we assessed it further, they just really, really missed their family back in Burundi. So just wanted to share some of that, just to know we are always learning, and our patients have a lot to teach us. So thank you.
Advance it here. There we go. Okay. Well, thank you very much for inviting me. I'm your neighbor right around the corner here, and have worked with APA for a very, very long time, including the years when I was a Fed, and thank Mary Ann for inviting me. Before I start, I gave you a handout that we used up on the Hill last week. It's an infogram about how you summarize data in a modern way for people who don't work on data, basically, on one side. And the other side are a whole series of asks that the counties have of the Congress for behavioral health care. And this was the first time ever that the National Association of Counties and my organization, County Behavioral Health Directors, actually worked together on a Hill briefing, and now we are going to do a whole series of Hill briefings going forward, including on the kind of topics that you're talking about here. Secondly, I want to point out a book that was published by my department at Hopkins called Public Mental Health. This is like the encyclopedia of mental health. So it starts with genetics, it goes through epidemiology, it goes through service organization, it goes to integration, and then it goes on to the future. And the future here, to put the line on it, is to say basically behavioral health is going to have to become much more a public health discipline going forward as we move ahead in the Affordable Care Act era. So now into my comments here, I want to pick up where Dr. Troutman left off exactly. The two headlines of what I'm going to talk about briefly here are that we absolutely have to pay attention to the social determinants because they influence everyone's life chances. And secondly, the approach to doing that is the population health approach. Now, I want to go back to the social determinants and walk down exactly what he said into behavioral health. So my own research, done now 10 years ago, shows that public mental health clients die on average 25 years younger than other people. And that was the data we had 10 years ago. Well, since then, we've parsed that down, and we can walk through the pieces of this, which are very instructive. So if you tell me you were born in poverty, I'm going to immediately take 5 years off your life. If you secondly tell me that you didn't graduate from high school, I'm going to take another 4 years. If you tell me that you had poorly treated depression or untreated depression, I'm going to take 5 more. And if you then tell me, well, you know, ultimately I was in the public mental health system in the state of Maryland or wherever, I'm going to take 11 more. So I immediately can accumulate and take 25 years off your life with 4 variables, basically. Now, the first variable here, poverty, and the second variable, lack of a high school education, really are social determinant type variables, and exactly the way Dr. Trautman was talking about. The third one here is a secondary effect of the social determinants, access to care, and the fourth one is a tertiary effect, lack of quality of care and good outcomes of care for a whole host of reasons. So the social determinants cascade down across a person's life in very definitive ways. When Secretary Sebelius was announcing her Healthy Hearts initiative a couple years ago, we actually looked into behavioral health care as part of that. And so if you look at heart disease, every year there are 616,000 deaths due to heart disease or stroke. If you look into the component of those 616,000 deaths, you'll find that over 5 years, the total is 3 million. Of the 3 million, 1 million cases, 1 million, are people with behavioral health conditions. We even know the mechanism. We know if you have depression, it's unpoorly treated, you have higher levels of cortisol in your blood system, which increases the likelihood 20 years out you're going to have a heart attack or stroke, and you're going to have a 40% chance of dying. We even know the mechanism. So these things are very fateful for people, and in our field, we absolutely have to get into this. The second point here on population health. A way for us to begin working on this is to subaggregate populations into comparable groups here, and I'll get into a few PowerPoint slides to show this, where you take a whole population and you walk it down into one subgroup, people who are perfectly healthy, they have no disease, they want to remain healthy and they want to improve their health, all the way over to another group on the other end here, people who have very serious illness. So let me go through a few PowerPoints here with you. I'm going to jump down through all of this to, well, I want to show you this. You've got a rare condition called good health. Frankly, we're not sure how to treat it, basically. So that's the problem of the disease care system, basically. So critical to what I'm talking about population health is the idea that disease and health are not two ends of the same continuum. Dr. Trautman made that case. The World Health Organization has known that for 60 years and so on. We published a paper in the early 80s that basically said you have to deal with this at least as two dimensions. So as soon as you deal with a dimension of health and a dimension of disease, you have the possibility of generating different population groups. And what I've done simply here is take this and parse it into 4 subgroups here. The people we deal with in behavioral health are in the lower right-hand quadrant, population 4. We hardly ever, if ever, deal with anybody in the other 3 quadrants in behavioral health. Huge lesson in that vis-a-vis us and the Affordable Care Act. So principles for us, we need to consider all 4 of these population groups. One can move among the groups, so you aren't forever consigned to population group 4. You can actually become a person in population group 1. Movement among the groups is best when both disease mitigation and health promotion and prevention strategies are employed together. And this is a model that you could apply to today's type activities. So in effect, we're talking in all four of these quadrants, starting with people who are in my population group four, people with high morbidity and mortality, little self-help or hope. If you move horizontally in this quadrant, you're doing traditional biopsychosocial interventions. We can't simply do that anymore. We have to add the vertical dimension of this, self-help, social support, change in unhealthy lifestyle, and so on, as a critical part of what we're doing. And unless we do both, we are not going to move people into the upper left-hand quadrant, recovery and health. Q&A will talk about health literacy and health activation. So, prediction for behavioral health and psychologists. Right now, you're in the lower right-hand quadrant. We're going to predict that you soon will be in the upper right-hand quadrant, where you're going to be dealing with wellness and adding health. You're going to move on to the lower left-hand quadrant on disease prevention. These are the people who don't have disease and don't want to get disease, but they aren't very healthy. And ultimately into the fourth quadrant, people who do not have any disease, who want to have wellness. So there's a huge agenda here for us in moving this ahead. One piece of this is integrated delivery systems. Again, these are not new ideas. What I'm showing you here is a graphic out of an article we published in 1978, where we were trying to create a health promotion organization. And the essence of the idea was you would come in, we would do a health hazard appraisal. Well, you know, you smoke, you have five major drinks a day, and we do the health hazard appraisal, and it says, well, you know, you're going to live three more years if you continue your current behavior. Then the issue becomes, what are the interventions we can do with that person to change that life expectancy? How do we move that 3 years out to 10 or move that 3 years out to 20? And there are different levels of this. The level psychologists have dealt with is the personal level. How do I work with this person to change that? How do I do behavioral interventions and so on? There's also a community level intervention. How do I work on this collectively in a local community in the way Dr. Troutman was talking about that? And there's a cultural level. How do I change the culture of smoking? We've changed the culture of smoking in the United States. It's no longer socially acceptable to smoke. We need to get to that level, and psychologists need to work at all three of those levels. So I'm going to stop. I see the X here. Thank you very much. And thank you very much here.
I now have a couple of questions for our panelists, and then we'll open up to the audience. First question, which you've all heard before, what is the most promising thing on the horizon related to integrated primary care, in this case, for health promotion, prevention, and well-being? Whoever would like to go first.
Well, let me start off a little bit on, and I don't know how much of this you said in the last day or so. So there's a huge opportunity on integrated care in the Affordable Care Act with Section 2703, which provides funds to create health homes. It provides both planning money and it provides funds to actually operate the system for up to 2 years with 90% federal financial participation. I think as we go into this in behavioral health, we don't go in hat in hand. We go in with a lot of positive things that we can bring to the situation. We can bring the concept of recovery to the situation, very important. We can also bring the concept of resiliency to that situation. No one else will be bringing those. So if I have high blood pressure and I go and get my high blood pressure treated, the physician will give me a pill to control my high blood pressure, which is maintenance. That is not recovery. No one will ask you, you know, why do you eat too much salt? Why do you have so much stress, et cetera? So we bring some new concepts in recovery and resilience to the table of integrated care via Section 2703. We also bring other things. We are the only people who bring peer support to that situation. Because of our situation in human resources, we've moved from, we were talking about this earlier this morning, a situation of a chronic problem to a crisis. Because of the implementation of the Affordable Care Act and all the new people being enrolled in the marketplace and the Medicaid expansion, we have huge numbers of new people who now have insurance who didn't before. We don't have the capacity to serve them. Peers are a very important ingredient of moving that agenda, and peers are very concerned with this issue of wellness and well-being. And they bring those skills to the table, which are very important here again in terms of us moving upstream in the way we've been talking about this morning.
Thank you.
For us, I think it's very exciting that finally payers are, for us at least, have been wanting to collaborate on more global payment, and I think even more importantly than global payment is shared savings. So finally, rather than us just absorbing the cost of these non-billable services that we, like prevention, and there is no code for, worked with parent on, helping a child sleep at night. So now we have global payment, so we, rather than having to piecemeal things based on a diagnosis code, we have more clinical flexibility to do what we think is best, and then the shared savings on the back end, that I think has a tremendous potential. So if the insurance company saves money because we were able to change someone's trajectory through our health behavior changes, then we get some of that. So I think that's very exciting because it just allows us to do more of this health prevention well-being and hopefully be part of those financial savings.
Thank you.
One of the things I've learned from working with politicians is never to answer the question, but to answer a different one and then bridge across. So forgive me. But so this is a view from England. I mentioned in my talk, but the X came up, so I didn't have a chance to address it. That that we've been developing a version of your primary care patient-centered medical home, which we've just simply called a primary care home, because it's the home of care for a population, and we've defined very clearly that the population size should be around 30 to 50,000, and we can talk about what the merits of that are, but it's developed around the idea of a total capitated budget with risk and reward incentives and a fully integrated workforce, which encompasses primary care, community care, mental health, and most importantly, some incentives based on how you interact with your community through all the various engagement vehicles that we've talked about, and just the what's exciting about that in terms of the outcomes for that kind of approach is that we're developing some metrics framed around the construct of well-being, and we're using patient activation measures to determine whether that sort of organizational vehicle is actually delivering against outcomes that matter to people rather than outcomes that you can easily measure in the traditional disease-oriented way.
Thank you. Okay. One other question. Building on Dr. Troutman's message this morning, what actions can we take as professionals, either individually or collectively, to make a difference in promoting health and well-being for the population?
Dr. Troutman did not say, but it's absolutely true. So literally this week, the Congress is doing what's called a reconciliation bill. And the reconciliation bill was passed by the House. Now it's in front of the Senate. Part of the reconciliation bill is to defund the Prevention and Wellness Fund that was part of the Affordable Care Act. We definitely do not want that to happen. That is basically the essential pool of money. It's too small as it is, but it's the essential pool of money that makes possible doing a lot of the things that we talked about here this morning. So one of the first things to do is advocacy on the Hill not to allow the Senate to defund the Prevention and Wellness Fund, which is operated by the Centers for Disease Control.
Thank you.
So from a clinical in the trenches perspective, I think it's incredibly important to create a culture within your entire teams, administratively, clinically, about understanding social determinants of health and health disparities. So it is essentially woven into our electronic health record. We want to know about the patients, what their perceived struggles and strengths are. We ask every single one, what do you value? What's important to you? And I think from a broader level, you know, it is not just in the clinical contact with the patient and trying to understand that culture and what they're struggling with and asking about things like transportation. Are you going to be able to get there? Did you eat today? For many of our, you know, you can say difficult, non-compliant, but when someone is eating food out of a garbage can, you're going to call them non-compliant with their diabetic, you know, self-management of diabetes. So I think it's important to ask the questions, to be mindful. I will give a huge shout out to Unnatural Causes. It is spectacular. We have all of our trainees watch it, and we have a facilitated discussion. And most of them who are very well accomplished and well-read, their eyes, they just kind of walk out like this, you know. And I think it's important to continually emphasize it culturally and clinically in that individual patient interaction as well as a group, so from macro to micro. And you can't stop. You're like never done. So we have to be unrelenting with it. Otherwise, it just kind of fades into the background of all the other demands.
Thank you.
I'm going to take a workforce development approach to this question. So in England, as we heard yesterday, there's a single national organization called Health Education England, which runs a budget around £5 billion for training and developing both today and tomorrow's workforce. And currently, the workforce in the National Health Service is around 1.3 million people. And so my answer would be we switch off the taps to highly specialist training, train more generalists, develop a population-based model to workforce planning, and create roles such as primary care navigators, community health champions, a greater focus on nursing, health visiting, midwifery, et cetera, et cetera. So, i.e., develop our workforce based on what our population needs.
Thank you. Then we'll open up for questions.
Thank you all so much. Boy, what an exciting morning. I have a question that I've just recently been paying some attention to, and I think all of you could probably speak to this. What are the policy levers to change direction from paying the most attention to the people who utilize the most care toward the people who need the most care?
Let me start here. The new secretary, Burwell, has two initiatives right now. One is called a system reform initiative, which you can read as integration. So what she's working very hard to do is integrate primary care with behavioral health, with public health, with dental health. Best examples of this right now are in Oregon, in the community care organizations in Oregon. Another initiative she had is what's called the Value Purchasing Initiative. And the Value Purchasing Initiative is rolling the money up into case rates, integrated case rates, that are performance adjusted. And the integrated case rates that are performance adjusted are a very powerful tool to drive where integration is going to go and where system reform is going to go. We absolutely, in behavioral health, have to be engaged at that table as this happens. And my members, who are all people from behavioral health, are having difficulty keeping up with these initiatives out in the field currently. So we have asked the secretary that, you know, in the field, in the counties and providers and peers, we need technical assistance on these initiatives to help us stay abreast of how they are evolving so that the train doesn't leave and we're left at the station here. So we need your help and APA's help in lobbying that issue with the secretary, and I think we're actually beginning to gain some traction on that.
policy levers for us, to be very honest, have been money and data. And so what we've had to do, and I was just at our Medicaid 10 care office last Thursday with all of our medical managed care organizations, is basically showing them that it's a very expensive model of care to only focus on your high utilizers, because the people who need the care most, it's not that they're not getting care, they are getting the care in the most expensive setting. So they are going to the ER, they're waiting much too long, and then they get use up a lot of that hospital dollars, then they have frequent readmissions. So I wish we could say we could plead with their sense of mission, but honestly, we've had to track data, and we focused on access to care because they have contracts, essentially, you know, they need to provide more access to care, and then money. How utilization amounts, ER visits, and the data are so compelling, it speaks for itself. So we've just shown them ER utilization. We just say, why don't you look at people who have a diagnosis of schizophrenia, depression, bipolar, how much ER utilization they have. That's it, and just compare to those. And then you tell us what you think is the best choice. So.
Brenda stole my answer there, which was around data. But if I can just I know that always goes down well with this audience. You just say the word data, it just generally works, isn't it? I was just going to say that one of the reasons that we're developing this primary care home model around that very defined population size is because one of the strengths of traditional British general practice was that you knew your list. You knew the people on your list, and the kind of multi-professional team would know where the challenges lay and who to go after and who to target, who to be proactive with, et cetera, et cetera. So if we multiply that forward now, and we've got risk profiling tools and all of these kinds of data sources available, we can do that in a much more sophisticated way. But that 30 to 50,000 limit, for me, it's probably terribly anecdotal, but it's a limit at which true clinical integration. If you exceed that population size, you lose your clinical integration because you don't know the names of everybody in your team by their first name. And that, for me, is the principle of integration. Know everyone's name by their first name, and you've got you've got their cell phone number, and you can call them up when you've got a problem. So that's why I think having that kind of model helps us to really target our resources to the people who need it most, and not necessarily the ones that we can easily measure.
Thank you.
Yes. Hi, Arthur Evans from Philadelphia. And I think it's been a really great morning. And I really appreciate hearing people starting to think about health differently, talking about health as opposed to healthcare, and thinking about social determinants. And in our work in Philadelphia, so we've tried to do what Ron has talked about, which is to get out of the quadrant, that one quadrant, and get into the other quadrants. I think there's been a mixed bag in terms of people's receptivity to that, right? Because of the way we're trained, the way we're trained to think about problems. And I really love the work that you're doing with Cherokee Health Systems. And I'd like to hear a little bit about strategies. You started to talk a little bit about that. Strategies that you've used to help move your organization, both from a philosophical standpoint, how do you get people to think differently about the problems, but more importantly, how do you get the structures within your organization to change? Because that's where a lot of the challenge is, because our systems are set up on a different way of thinking, a different way of approaching problems. And one of the challenges we're going to have as we start to move to a health promotion way of thinking is to change structures. And so if you could talk a little bit about that, I think would be helpful.
Someone said this yesterday, and I just want to highlight the importance of leadership, because if you have a strong leader and actually a team of leaders and some core change agents, and it doesn't have to be the CEO who's the change agent. In some of our clinics, there's a front desk person who lives in that community, and if you want to change anything in that clinic, you go to her, and she's the change agent. So I think it's very important to highlight having strong leaders, because they set the tone and recognize everything shows, every decision you make, everything, you know, shows. So I think a big mistake people make is they speak a lot of great language, but then they make decisions that letter completely counter to that. So I think number one is leadership, and number two is how you organize your clinical teams, how you organize the expectations. So for example, I love that idea, like, you know, everyone needs to know everyone's first name. When we have treatment teams, everybody comes, our office manager comes. If you sat at any of our treatment teams every week, you would not know who's the physician, who's the psychiatrist, who's the case manager. You know, people sit in on it and they say, we couldn't tell who was who. So it is that kind of continual process. And then I think the most important thing is staff selection, because I hate saying this as a psychologist, it's really hard to change people. And so their personalities, it's hard with their personalities. And there are some personalities that just are not a good fit for us. Mm-hmm. And so we will just say, you know, we've had some people who are great clinicians, great in their fields, but we can tell. They say my a lot, me, my office. They, you know, and that is just not a good fit. And so I think that staff selection, our CEO says his two main job titles are holder of our corporate and organizational values and chief talent scout. Mm. And he said, if I can do those two things, then, you know, I've done my job.
Anyone else?
Hey there, Ben Miller, Colorado. Okay. Great job, great panel. A quick question. I think you all have danced around this just a little bit, but let's talk about the role of measurement, because it seems like this is an area that we have misstepped greatly in healthcare. And so if all the things that you've described are as important as they are, how do we measure that? It seems like we don't have a system that's currently set up to measure the proper things, and I'm wondering if you could comment on that.
So I guess first an editorial comment about measurement that the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services probably has 2,500 process and outcome measures right now, and translate that as you have nothing, because nobody's going to use 2,500 outcome and performance measures and process measures and so on. So there are some promising things in this particular area. For example, there's work that was done by the NIH on PROMIS measures, the Patient Reported Outcome Measurement Information System, that has the dimensionality to look at well-being. And that's now being implemented in various places. One example of that would be, there's an IOM panel right now looking at how we go about defining adults with serious mental illness. And the question on the table is, should we approach that problem from a deficit point of view, which is what we've done historically, or should we approach it from a strengths point of view? The PROMIS measures would allow you to approach that problem from a strengths-based point of view. One other comment about measurement, there is advocacy out there to create national well-being accounts, just as we have national economic accounts. We're a little behind other countries in doing this, and what I'll do, if I haven't shared it, I'll share papers that you all can read about that work, basically.
Again, this is a really good question, and it's something that we're grappling with in our healthcare system to turn the dial towards well-being as opposed to the sort of biomedical measurements that we traditionally use, or resource utilization measures that we use. So we've been playing with, I mentioned earlier, the patient activation measure, which gives it, I don't know if you're familiar with it, I'm sure you are, it's got four scales of activation, or four phases of activation. At the one end, the patient's an advocate for their own health, that's phase four, and phase one is where they're totally passive recipients of healthcare, and the aim is to get as much of the population along that activation score as possible. And the other metric that we're trying to develop is framed around a well-being tool called WEMWEBS, the Warwick Edinburgh Mental Wellbeing Score. And there's a shortened version of that which gives an idea of how well people feel. It's not a measure of depression or anxiety, but it's a measure of how well people feel, and to kind of use that as a sort of composite measure of how your interventions are affecting wellness. And I would say there's a bunch of data people who are going to talk about this sort of stuff later, but it's just to kind of throw that kind of where we're at in the NHS and in England at the moment.
Yeah, I 100% agree. We have pretty pathetic measures, frankly, and we're quite behind the eight ball on that. So what we've been doing is we use proxies, you know, so we grab what we can, and they're still not good enough. But what we look at is, if you look at the beginning, one of my slides, it says integration is a means to an end. So we look at access. We look at all the clinical quality metrics that we can. But we look at things like utilization, ER, we look at claims data. We ask patients what their goal is. So we actually write out, you know, what are your goals? And we always ask, are you living a life that is consistent with your values? You know, that's interesting. It's important to know that someone may look terrible on some of these metrics, but they're living, like, they feel good about their life. So, you know, just because by our measure, you know, they look very sick, they are able to do things and function in a way, and we actually report it and we track it. So now we finally have a way to, you know, progressing, not progressing, are we maintaining it? And then we get very as specific as possible. So we found with our patients, global measures just don't work as well. With our safety net population, we have tried every, you know, the CDC quality of life measure, and people will like say, I've been feeling bad for 35 years. And so what we have done is what we've realized is the global measures maybe aren't as helpful to us, but we get very specific. So for our prenatal clinic, our number one goal is, did this mom deliver a baby who does not have low birth weight and is not addicted to opiates, and she actually got to take her baby home and it was not taken by DCS? Mm. That's that. For our BMI, for our kids with obesity, we track BMI and we use ZBMI, which is a standard BMI. So we track that. We track, are they eating more fruits and vegetables? Are they watching less TV? Are they eating less, drinking less sweetened beverages? And what we found, frankly, the two most important thing is getting them to watch less TV and reduce their sweetened beverage intake. If we can do that, we get statistically significant reductions in ZBMI. So they're specific. We have not found a good global measure of well-being with at least our safety net populations that will be a useful metric, not just a general metric, but what's going to help us, what's going to be useful to us in our care model and our partnership with them.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Thank you.